as we mentioned last time, this part of the course will be dealing with textile finishing. This basically is an introductory course, and we do not hope to go into details of every aspect, just want to introduce the topic to you. And if we look at the objectives, probably we will be like to, we will like to, you know, talk about, give you certain concepts and principles involved in finishing, and also give you an overview of various finishing processes and technologies involved. The details, the absolute theories that are governing these kinds of things probably will be done in a later class if you want to join advanced course. Otherwise, we will try to concentrate only on an overview so that you start appreciating as to what the finishing is all about. The first lecture obviously is what we call the general introduction as to what this topic is going to talk about. Probably we would like to answer questions as to what do we understand by the term finishing. You see, it's quite remarkable that in textile chemical processing we have terms like dyeing and finishing. The dyers probably have taken care of the spelling, we have not been able to take care of spelling also. But I'm sure you appreciate that we are not interested in mass killing and burial. There is something else to it, and that is what we would like to learn. And in the whole sequence of the unit operations of chemical processing of textiles, where does the finishing actually fit in? This also we would like to learn. And of course, this is the most important part as to why do we need it at all. The purpose of finishing certainly is what is going to be important, otherwise it doesn't fall in the basic teaching sequence. Let me just recall with you, because you know quite a lot about the chemical processing, you've done one course already. What does it involve? I'm sure the first process that you have seen earlier and must have been told about is singeing. What do you understand by singeing? Anybody can like to suggest, what do we do in singeing? What do you expect in this process?
The protruding fibers are burnt by passing over
So basically you want to make the surface smooth. The next process in this particular sequence is desizing. And what do we expect here?
To remove the size.
The size which we applied during the weaving process, we want to remove this. Then the other process which is also important is scouring. In this we expect to remove some of the impurities that we have. And finally we bleach. If we require, sometimes we want to sell half bleached or unbleached fabrics also. Most of the times we may be interested in bleaching, getting a white. Particularly if I want to dye a pale shade, light blue, light yellow and things like that, I would be interested in bleaching. But if I am going for deep shades like dark blue or black itself, then I may not bleach at all. I go for the simple scouring and then go for dyeing or whatever. There is a term, mesmerization, you have heard probably already. This also fits in somewhere in the sequence of operations. And these days it is possible to go for grey mesmerization, but you immediately after singeing or sometimes even before singeing or together, you may do grey mesmerization, or generally one prefers to do mesmerization after bleaching. It also has its own advantages. Finally, the coloration process. This is a part of the unit operation where we do the apply color, whatever we call a dyeing. This is the most important, one of the most important processes that we have. And the other part, which also will be a part of this course, will be the printing part. where you apply color in patterns, designs, and not actually put the color all over the place. So this will be the difference between the dyeing and printing, but the dyes applied are going to be approximately same based on the requirement of the fiber concerned. Finally, the last operation that we have is what we call finishing, about which this course is going to be talking about. Now, as it says that it is the last operation, therefore it is actually finishing the whole chemical operation. After this, basically it is folding, inspection, etc., etc., and packaging. And therefore, being the last operation, I think the name that has picked up is from there, that you finish the whole chemical processing sequence, and also finish as such has a different connotation in the sense that you finish a product to design a specific requirement. The immediate question that one obviously might like to ask is, after all, what is the purpose? Why do we want to have this operation at all? This operation basically has two functions, and one of the functions is an aesthetic function. You may have dyed the fabric very nicely with beautiful colors, brilliant colors, with high tinctorial value. You may have had a nice beautiful design, and if you are not able to present it well to the customer, I'm sure you are going to lose on the market value, on the sale, and the money that you're going to receive is going to be less. So one of the purpose of the finishing processes is improving the aesthetic qualities. Like if it is wrinkled material, I'm sure you will not like to buy it. The first look would be, first situation would be to basically ignore the whole thing, leave it out, and only look at the other product which are relatively better. But this is not the only process, or that is not the only function or the purpose for which we do the finishing. It's important. Like you do ironing and the appearance becomes better, instead of ironing we do something else in a continuous manner. But other than that, we have functional requirements. Functional requirement means that we want to improve the properties of the fiber fabrics. All the textile materials have certain advantages, some plus points, some negative points. All that you wanted always is not available, and if it is not available, you want to compensate this. That means you want to improve the functional requirement of a textile fabric or the garment, which means that you are probably looking for the limitations or the drawbacks of the fibers. In case you understand the drawbacks of the fibers, then there are chances that you would know what kind of a thing should be done so that those drawbacks could be partially offset. It is not probably possible to completely gain everything what you want to. You may be wanting absolute good resiliency, you may want comfort, you may want warmth, you may want everything else, but everything you may not get it. But at least if you understand the drawbacks, there is a possibility that we might do something so that those drawbacks are partially offset. That is what is the functional requirement. And as we proceed, you will learn that this finishing, therefore, is not a small subject. It's a very vast subject. Its chemistry and technology is pretty vast. There are many aspects which need to be improved, and therefore you need different kinds of chemicals. When I'm talking about dyes, for example, dyes have a particular role to play to give color. Well, you have different kinds of dyes, different groups and all. But here, if I am interested in chemicals, I may be interested in all types of chemicals and all types of chemical reactions which may give me certain properties which I desire. So it probably is worthwhile if we look at the fiber properties. I am sure you have already done a course on the fibers, so I don't want to get into the fibers themselves, but it would be worthwhile if we somehow just glance through some of the things which will be important for us for this particular course to know about. Let us look at cotton and viscose. I have clubbed these two fibers together. What is common in cotton and viscose?
Cellulose.
Now, before I go further, though some of the properties like drape, okay, the strength, the permeability, all those kinds of things can be changed by changing the yarn construction or a fabric construction. For example, knitted fabrics are always little softer to handle, they bend very easily. Woven fabrics are relatively stiffer. Well, otherwise also you can make them softer by changing the ends and picks. You can make a highly twisted yarn or a soft twisted yarn and make different, you know, some of the properties can be changed, but not all. For example, if cotton fiber burns, so even if you make it knitted fabric or a woven fabric, just by construction you will not be able to save it from burning. So these type of properties basically are governed by the chemical structure. Therefore, when you said these two fibers are basically cellulosic, so the cellulosic, by being cellulosic, they have certain properties. And probably you already must have been told that cotton fibers and of course viscose also have poor resiliency. You know, resiliency is a term which includes two terms. It includes resistance to deformation as well as recovery from deformation. In general, I think I'll be more interested in recovery. Even if it resists more, it is not probably very happy. For example, if I start wearing glass fabric, obviously it will resist all kinds of deformation, but I will not be very comfortable. So not necessarily I am always interested in resistance to deformation. Well, it is also one of the properties. Those which resist more obviously recover also better from deformation generally. Not necessarily always, but generally it may be true. But if recovery from deformation is good, I will be very happy. For example, I would not have creases being formed. And this is the main problem which we find with cellulosic fibers. Cotton shirts, you have seen, bed sheets, other kind of things, they just develop creases very soon. So resiliency is basically a term which encompasses the recovery from deformation aspects, bending, torsion, all kinds of things. It has poor resilience. We'll look into the reasons why it has poor resiliency later. But it has. For example, compared to polyester shirt that you wear, you know, you find it that this creases faster. So you might like to improve upon it. Then the dimensional stability. What I mean by dimensional stability, for example, if I make a trouser, I don't want after washing it should become a short, right? It has been a common knowledge that cotton fabrics shrink, that is, they do not maintain their dimensions. And some people used to earlier say that please wash the fabrics before you give it for stitching. Gone are those days. We understand much more, and therefore we can control this change in dimension, the tendency to change in dimension. It has something to do, particularly in the case of cotton and viscose type of fabrics, is absorption of moisture. They swell, and because of swelling, the dimensions change. And because we understand this process, so chances are that we are able to take care of this in the beginning itself, so that the customer doesn't suffer at the end. So this is one of the limitations of these kinds of fibers which we must know and therefore work on it. Though this thing does not happen. For example, in certain other fibers you might find as you keep on bending your arm or keep on bending your knees, there is a bagginess. It doesn't recover. It extends permanently. That also we don't want. But those kinds of problems are not there with cotton viscose. They may be problems with something else, where the fiber or the yarn or from this construction is able to open out and cannot go back. So you get a bagginess, which also is bad. That's also a dimensionally unstable system. But here we have generally shrinkage is what we basically understand. The other thing, I'm not sure whether you have experienced, but if you keep cotton fabric in a garden soil for about 1 week, come back and try to see what has happened to this. You'll feel the strength of this fabric probably has been lost by more than 50%. And if you keep it for 2 weeks, probably it will be almost like zero. Otherwise, very strong fabric. Just put it in the soil, garden soil, nothing will be there. The bacteria, the microorganisms act very fast on these cellulosic systems. In fact, the purer is the cellulose, the faster it is attacked. That is, the normal impurities which are present probably inhibit the action of microorganisms. But in case we have pure bleached, purified cotton, then the chances are it will get deteriorated much faster. Normally you will say, what is the point in discussing these kind of things, I am not going to bury my cotton shirt. Well, true. But microorganisms can develop even without burying them. Have you ever tried to smell a shirt which you wore for 2 days and did not wash, kept it in the cupboard, and after 1 week you come and see that? Have you tried to smell it? Try to do that. You won't enjoy it. In fact, some people had experienced in foundry and those kinds of workshops where the temperatures are very high and you have to wear an overall. Overall, people generally don't wash anyway. So what you do is come to the factory, put an overall, start working, keep on sweating. In the end, evening, just put it somewhere else, come next day, start wear again. That person who is wearing the overall gets somehow accustomed to that kind of a smell. But they say neither supervisor nor anybody else can come near him. But that is because of the bacteria grows. And if bacteria grows, it of course, like the body sweat and all those kinds of things, the fluids that are there deposited, the bacteria starts growing there. And that can also start eating up the cellulose, because some of these bacteria do contain cellulase. You understand cellulase? The cellulase is your enzyme. Various kinds of cellulases are there, not one type. You may have heard in the desizing process also. So this type of a system is available, and therefore it can destroy the cellulose, and ultimately the strength can go down, apart from the smell. So sometimes, therefore, one has to work on these things also. What about insects? Normally, insects do not trouble cotton. You can keep it there. Somehow they are not very happy with the eating of cellulose as such, except maybe termite. If it happens to go through there, then it will pass through the books as well as through the clothes and all kinds of things. But normal insects like silverfish and whatever you see in the day-to-day household stuff, they are not interested in cellulose, so you are quite safe from that point of view. Resistance to flame. One is resistance to thermal degradation. For example, if you iron or you do this thing and you boil in boiling water, nothing happens to cellulose. It's quite stable. That's why you can see those medical people, sterilizing their, you know, linen by boiling or steaming, nothing happens, it's fine. But if you ignite where the temperatures are about 450 plus degrees, you will find within few seconds, if a curtain is hanging, it can finish. Just like that. You put light a matchbox, bat stick at the bottom, and you will see within a few seconds there is no curtain left. It just vanishes. Viscose does faster than cotton. So this is a problem. And obviously, it so happens that in India we do not have a legislation which governs this problem. But in Europe and Western countries, they have legislation in the sense that all the night wears and children's wear must be flame retarded, irrespective of what fiber you use, because you are not sure, and those children are aware of these things, and in the night one is never sure what will happen, so there should be some safety. Probably this will come to India also, as we are progressing, we are understanding situations, and then we become little more rich, maybe things are going to be there, but we are going to learn about it also. Water repellency. What do you think about this? If I have a cotton t-shirt or whatever, want to move around, will it be repellent? It absorbs moisture. Cellulose absorbs moisture. Cellulose is hydrophilic. It absorbs lot of moisture. And therefore, in case we are interested, we may not be interested. I don't want to make my shirt to be repellent all the time or waterproof for that time. But in case I want to make certain things repellent, then I will have to do something to it, because by itself it is not going to be water repellent. That's for sure. Chemical resistance. Generally, chemical resistance of these fibers is not very bad. Of course, concentrated acids, even 50% or so, will start degrading them. Alkali, they are quite stable. Organic solvents, they are quite stable. Nothing happens, you know, with organic solvents to the cellulose. So, and if of course it is not resistant to let's say strong acid, I'm not sure whether it is worthwhile to make it resistant to strong acids, because what will I do probably is I'll change the chemical groups, react to something else, substitute with something else, and ultimately I'll find I am not dealing with cotton, I am dealing with something else. So if there was any advantage of cotton, that would be gone. So probably I may not be interested in trying to improve resistance, etc. Whenever, if I suppose I am working in a chemical factory and I want a system to protect me, I'll go for something else rather than go for cotton clothes. I think that is what probably will be better, rather than, of course, we know this fiber. There is another term which is called comfort. I think people are always happy with comfort of the cotton, isn't it? Or cellulosics. All undergarments are supposed to be, at least in these climates, climatic conditions of tropical climate, we want cotton. We always feel that cotton is much more comfortable. In cold countries, for example, they don't bother. They have acrylic vests and nylon underwears and all kinds of things are there, and one is quite comfortable. But here, we do find it's difficult, and this material, because it absorbs moisture, therefore you start feeling comfortable. Unfortunately, over the last about two decades or so, the concept of the comfort also has changed. It is not necessary that just because something absorbs moisture, therefore it is more comfortable. What is more comfortable will be that it absorbs moisture but doesn't let you feel the moisture. That is, the portion which is close to the skin remains dry. And this must have started in Western countries again out of necessity, which of course we have understood now, like ever dry nappies, that they are always dry. What I mean basically is that there the mothers did not have so much time to change nappies every half an hour, working mothers maybe, and children used to develop a lot of rashes. So this was a necessity You had to develop something like this, which you can leave and not bother for a few hours and still find that no disease is developing. And therefore, this concept of ever dry nappies or other kind of things that sanitary wear these days we have, this also is a concept where the fabric next to skin is dry. And how can it be dry? If it is absorbent material, it is already wet. Therefore, you need systems which transport the moisture rather than absorb the moisture. So today, probably polypropylene, which doesn't absorb any moisture at all, happens to be the best fiber for this purpose. Because these days are structured fabrics, they are called structured assemblies, where there is a layer which can absorb the moisture, there is a layer which remains in contact with the skin, and there can be a third layer which makes sure that the other garments do not get soiled. So you have 3-4 layered structures which does many kinds of functions, and this is important. So from that point of view, one can always question the comfort of cotton also, but as such we are quite happy about it. We will not keep on getting bothered. What about other fabrics like jute, flax and rami and other cellulosic fibers? Well, till now I think we are quite sure that these fibers are not meant for, at least jute and rami are not meant for apparel. Flax, which is in the fabric form, is also known as linen, is. So in case you are interested in flax, almost same problems which exist are going to be there. Jute and rami type of systems are mostly going to be used for industrial applications or sacks, etc. There maybe you are more interested in mildew resistance, because they are going to be in contact with the ground more often. They may be interested in resistance to flame also. Maybe you are interested in repellency also, because you may be wanting to store fertilizers, right? And things like that. But resiliency and dimensional stability, etc., probably you are not going to bother so much about it, because they are not going to be used for apparel. The other important fiber that we have and we must talk about, obviously, is wool. What do you think about the resiliency of wool compared to the fibers that we were discussing? Yes, it is much better. It's much better. Can you give me any reasons for that?
The structure of wool.
That is?
The zigzag structure, moreover the cistern linkage. It has a natural crimp. Mm-hmm. So whenever it is deformed, it tends to regain the shape.
The crimp which you are talking about is a macro level system. The resiliency that is basically there is a micro level problem. So partly you were right when you talk about cystine linkages. Otherwise also, when you talk about the thing, the full fiber at the molecular level has got helical structure, not zigzag. It's alpha helix, it's called. Also, there is extensive hydrogen bonding. Both intermolecular as well as intramolecular. You have hydrogen bonding intermolecular also. And you have, for example, intramolecular hydrogen bonding also. Because of this nature, if you try to open a spring, the natural most energetically favorable configuration is helical configuration. So whenever we get a chance, it will like to go back to this structure, because this is naturally more favorable polypeptide structure. Okay. Also, they have electrovalent bonds, salt linkages. There is no doubt they have van der Waal forces also. There is something else also wool has, which is the covalent bond. Intermolecular covalent bonding. Intermolecular covalent bonding. In addition to this, proteins also exhibit something what we call as the hydrophobic bonds. Hydrophobic bonds, or it is also known as reciprocal hydrophilic effect. Hydrophobic bonds, or which basically is reciprocal hydrophilic effect. What do you mean by reciprocal hydrophilic effect? That is, in the presence of water, these forces act. In the dry state, they don't. You have heard of micelles. Why does micelles form? Because the general environment of aqueous medium they don't like. So they want to come together, group together, so that all hydrophobic parts come together and then the energy is reduced. Same happens here also, that a protein molecule like wool is a protein. What kind of protein is? Name of a protein? Anyone?
Keratin.
Keratin. So it's a keratin protein, and obviously it has hydrophobic amino acids also, and those hydrophobic amino acids try to come together, group together, the moment they come in aqueous environment. You put it in the water, so they don't like water, so they have to come together. That becomes also hydrophobic bonds, we call them sometimes reciprocal hydrophilic effect. Now all these together make wool a much more resilient fiber. Much more resilient fiber. That does not mean that we might not like to improve resiliency. We might still like to improve resiliency, but as such, relative to the other fiber that we were talking about, it is certainly very good. Is wool hydrophilic or hydrophobic fiber? Sure, sir, bolo.
Hydrophobic.
Anybody else? What is the moisture regain of a scoured wool at standard conditions? Moisture regain. It's about 16%. 13 to 16%. Well, depends on the type of wool you're talking about. And what about the moisture gain of cotton?
8%.
What about the moisture gain of viscose?
11 to 12%.
So, would you like to consider this as a hydrophilic fiber or a hydrophobic fiber? Basically, it's also hydrophilic fiber. It's got certain portions which are hydrophobic. That doesn't mean the whole of the fiber is hydrophobic. It's a hydrophilic fiber. And therefore, it also absorbs moisture. And if there will be a change in dimension because of the swelling, it would occur here also. It so happens that the type of garments that we make out of wool fibers are not exactly the same as cotton. Generally, they are more light twisted, soft twisted, not so hard twisted. And for example, the one which you use for sweaters, which is a knitting material, is very soft twisted. So the behavior may be slightly different. But it does have a problem. The shrinkage which occurs in garments and yarns and all kinds of things is also because of the stored tensions. Whenever I stretch a material and leave it like this, let's say I wet it, stretch it, leave it like this, you will find that it doesn't shrink. But the moment you put in water, it will shrink. So if you leave back some strains, or the material wants to swell, all these processes are going to lead to shrinkages and dimensional instability. It also will have problems. And therefore, sometimes people do want to give it more dimensional stable structure than it has by itself. You might like to. There is another concept which I will be talking just after a few minutes. Thermal stability, you must answer, compared to cotton. You have to speak little louder. Yeah. Is it poor or better than cotton? Poorer?
Better than cotton.
Better than cotton. Thermal stability? Yeah. Anyone else from behind? What do you say, Sid Gupta?
So better than cotton.
Better than cotton? Well, that's not true. Have you ever tried to iron your woolen coat? No. Everybody says, please put a wet cloth first and then iron. Okay, no. Why do you do that? That means, while cotton you can iron just like that, the setting they fell. You have seen the setting on the iron, which is much higher temperature than wool setting. So obviously, if it had better thermal stability, you would be doing that. So remember that. It's not better. It would degrade, it would yellow. And so it's a delicate fiber compared to cotton, and you got to treat it little more delicately. Okay? So from that point of view, you got to take care relatively. Moth attack. It is susceptible to attack. It can, that's what I'm saying. So it is susceptible to attack from the moth, and therefore you have to protect it against it. So this is the weakness. Mildew. Generally, microorganisms as such do not grow and try to eat it up very nicely. It's not so easy to eat it up. But the smell problem can be there. Like your body fluids, if they get absorbed on the fiber or fabric, and then bacteria can develop on them, even if you do not lose strength, you may still not like it. So in case that is the problem, we might like to give a treatment like that. Otherwise, as such, you don't have so much of a problem here. Water repellency. Now can we talk about it? What do you think? Is it there? Is it repellent? Relatively, we talk about in relative terms, you know. It is not possible to talk always in absolute terms, then we have to do experiments of different kinds. Less relative to cotton, for example, you think it is going to be more repellent?
Less repellent.
So there are two answers and both of them are here. So we have to select one.
So it is hydrophilic.
It is hydrophilic. The other one also is hydrophilic. It so happens, probably you may have studied in the wool, that the wool wax naturally occurring in the fiber is much large, because repellency has something to do with the surface. You know, probably you may understand, repellency has nothing to do with what is happening in the bulk of the fiber. Repellency has much more to do only with the surface. If suppose there is more amount of wax, at least it will be repelled. But if you keep on putting and soaking in, maybe things would move in. So raw wool particularly will be much more repellent. The other wool also will be repellent relatively. But it still does not make sure that you wear a woolen garment and walk in the rain. No. So if you want that kind of repellency, you will have to do the treatment. Certainly you can't use raw wool. Raw wool is not usable. So you'll be using a purified wool, scoured wool, but after making the garment, if you want repellency, then you will have to do certain treatments also. That is truth.
Fleece.
flame retardancy. You must say something about this. Wool. Yes, this is probably the only fiber, not only, the other fiber also. There is one of those fibers which are called self-extinguishing fibers. What do you mean by that? You put it in the flame, it may start, it may catch fire, you take it out of the flame, it will stop burning. Okay? Correct? So as such, one can say that this is the safest fiber from flame retardancy point of view. But it cannot be accepted as it is. If you really think I want to make a flame retardant fabric out of wool, then the natural property that it has, which is pretty good, is not sufficient. For example, the severe most burning test, which we call, is take a fabric, strip, and burn from the bottom. It starts burning. The heat produced from the burning material burns the rest of the material because heat goes up. So you find if you burn from the top, that you start burning from the top, it may extinguish. If you start burning from the bottom, it may not. Get the point? Because burning process, all oxidation processes for that matter, are exothermic. And this is also an exothermic process, produces a lot of heat, and that heat sometimes, more often, in fact in all case of polymeric substance, is more often sufficient to burn the rest of the material. What we call is vertical flame test. Vertical flame test. This is the most severe test. I mean, you can make tests generally severe than that. You can force it, the burner, you know, industrial burner can be thrown onto the fabric. Well, that could be more severe test. You can pour molten metal onto that, that will be still more severe test. But in general, when you talk about flame test, instead of top burning, bottom burning is by naturally, it is one of the severe most test, and wool fabric is not going to withstand that. And if it does not, then obviously, and if you are interested in making it flame proof, then you got to do something about it also. Chemical resistance. Relatively stronger or weaker? Is it more susceptible to attack by acids or by alkali? Alkali. 5%, 2% caustic soda, little boil, it's gone. So it's relatively weaker. Organic solvents, not so much of a problem, but inorganic solvents, solutions of inorganic salts, etc., can cause problems, as well as some degradation can occur with acids also, particularly if they are very concentrated. Okay, and again the same question, we may not be interested in changing this, but there is one more thing which is only specific to wool. Felting. What is felting?
Treatment with any which treatment with a particular chemical
get a desired sort of property, and most probably it is NaOH
for felting.
It's a process by which these blankets and all the paper is made.
Yes,
correct. Felts are those fabrics which are neither woven nor knitted. They are non-wovens, you know, they come in the category of non-wovens. You take a bunch of fibers and then, you know, allow them to interact with each other by mechanical action, and you find that they cannot come out, they disentangle and then they stay there and make a fabric out of it. Fabric. That's the kind of thing we see in the wool. Why does it happen? It happens only with wool. And we have learnt a lot from wool, and then we started making non-wools of different types these days, without wool also. But the first material, the woolen felt hats the ladies used to wear, and all kinds of systems were basically made from wool. You have any idea? No? Why does the wool felt?
Because of its natural print.
natural crime. Anything else? No problem. This is what we are supposed to learn. Therefore, I am spending little more time on fibers than I should have done it, but doesn't matter. It is worthwhile, isn't it? It is because of the fact that it has got
scaly structures.
Scales on the surface. If you look at the wool fiber, I am drawing not very nicely, but sorry. Things like this. These are the tips. These are the scales which cover the fiber, and they are pointing towards the tip of the fiber. The scales are pointing towards the tip of the fiber. Effect that when given a chance, this fiber will have a tendency to move towards its root. This is called unidirectional motion of these fibers. Have you ever done those tricks which the village people do quite a lot, you know, take the flower part of the wheat or the barley and put it upside down and under the pants, and it just moves up as you move on. Unidirectional motion. And so all the fibers will have a tendency to move towards the root till they jumble up, entangle, and nothing can move. So you may have seen the knitted sweaters under the armpits, for example, they become a compact mass, but the rest of the fabric is very soft, smooth, open, and these kind of the back part portion of the thing becomes very compact and hard, stiff. Permeability reduces quite a lot, and obviously is not very aesthetic. This happens particularly with wool because it has got scales. Because if you move your finger in this direction and you move your finger in this direction, the friction is different. Because of the differential frictional effect, we get felting, and we get a lot of shrinkage because of felting. I mean, this shrinkage is specific only to wool fiber and wool garments. These days, of course, we have material which is not supposed to shrink, and that is what the finishing is all about. We must understand this problem and do something. Yeah.
So how is shrinking related to the felting? Like this scaly structure.
Basically, it allows the mass to keep on becoming compact. Density keeps on increasing, and this process will continue, keep on continuing till the fibers can move, and the fibers will stop moving only when they become completely dense.
Unidirectional motion, sir. They are moving towards their root. What's the meaning of their moving towards their root? The fibers are.
If you have a normal fiber,
yes, sir.
You bend it, you twist it, the garments squeeze, do something about it. You'll find that some of the fibers will move in one direction, they may have a tendency to come back also. But this fiber, once it has been moved from its position, it will not come back to its position. Because coming back, for example, in this direction is very difficult for this fiber. It's always is possible, the moment you try to do any kind of squeezing mechanical action, it will always have a very easy way to go in this direction. Keep on moving in this direction till everything is jammed. And this leads to a lot of shrinkage. In fact, once the fibers have felted, it is impossible almost to separate the fibers out. They get mixed up, jumbled up, interlocked in such a bad way that is you can't recover the fiber. If you have a yarn, you can untwist the yarn, take the fibers out. In fabric, take the yarns out, take untwist the yarn, get the fibers out. After they are felted properly, nothing you can do about it. So this is one problem which particularly has to be solved if you are interested in suitings. You don't want a 1,000 rupee a meter suit to go just like that. So therefore one has to be very careful. This is one of the problems with the wool. Only with the wool, because this is the only fallible scales. Fine wool has got more problems than the coarse wool. Fine wool is the more costly wool. The finer the wool, the more is the problem, the more is the cost. So you have to solve it. Can't ignore this problem. The other protein fiber which is also of interest to us is silk. What kind of a protein it is?
Fibroin and sericin.
Sericin is not the fibrous one, it is the gum, which obviously is taken out. Fibroin is the one which is more important for us. And it does not have scales, so silk doesn't have scales, so it doesn't felt. It is relatively much more stable to wool, comparatively more stable to wool, in alkali also. Probably somebody may have told you already that it crystallizes also much more than wool. Of course, it is the only natural filament fiber. The lengths are much more, something like 500 meters to 1000 meter length you can get uninterrupted. So it's one of the system, and it's much more shiny, all kinds of, you know, it's a luxurious fiber, costly and luxurious fiber. It's produced much less, and we are quite proud of the fact that today India happens to be the second largest country or seller of silk, exporter of silk, producer of silk in the world after China. If you look at the problems like this, we will say resiliency probably is not good, as good as wool. It crushes, it can form creases. Dimensional stability doesn't have felting from that point of view, because dimensional stability will be governed by felting process also. From that point of view, maybe it is better relatively. Thermal stability is not too good, because silk also got to be very careful in ironing. You can't just keep on ironing. Moth does not attack it, but some other insects like silverfish do attack. Moth is a different kind of a beetle, and the silverfish is a different kind of an insect. Both are insects, they don't attack. Mildew problem will be there, again the same kind of a thing, that the mildew will grow on the adhered sebum and all those kinds of body fluids which get attached. Water repellency you will have to treat if you want. Flame retardancy, it is also self-extinguishing like wool, but again, if you really want a flame retardant material, you got to work. Chemical resistance, relatively better, but as I told you, probably we are not interested so much. Resistance to chlorine is not very high. In fact, proteins have some problems, and therefore we don't go for chlorine bleach here. You got to go for, if it are to bleach, go for hydrogen peroxide bleach, don't go for chlorine bleach. So that's one. We would not like to improve the resistance to chlorine, we rather avoid the chlorine thing. But sometimes you may not be able to avoid, your water may be containing a lot of chlorine, then there may be some problems. Most of the people in wool and in the case of silk go for dry cleaning, but it is not necessary always to go for dry cleaning, because in West the concept has come, you should be able to take a garment, machine wash it. In case even jackets, woolen jackets also, you would like to machine wash, and therefore some finishing treatments must be given so that it becomes machine washable, because dry cleaning is very costly. It's not that we can't afford it, I think nobody would like to afford dry cleaning. It's a slow process, you have to handle the garments, and cost becomes much more. There is one very important thing which people do. This is not a property, I'm sorry, don't consider this a property, weighting. Weighting is something which is done. Like you said, we have what we call as gum or sericin. There is a process which is called degumming. Degumming process. When we remove the gum, the weight loss occurs. A silk which sells at such a high price, you would like to throw 20% of the weight in the drain, which you have to do. So 20% means a lot. So people have been increasing the weight of the fabric after everything else has been done, which is called a weighting process. You increase the weight. It not only increases the weight of the fabric, but also it increases the, as what they call, you know, the body of the fabric, right? And the last few things which also are done to silk, one is called a scroopy handle. Scroopy handle is sometimes imparted, you know, when you, somebody walks in a silk garment, you know, the sound comes, like rustling sound. That is very, very specific, very specific. And therefore, this kind of a thing has to be given. It is also less stable to ultraviolet light. Normally, it doesn't have to be exposed, but well, that's it. We may have to do it sometimes. Okay? So, we'll stop it here.
Rolling is the process of producing different components by plastic deformation of work material by passing it between rotating rolls. The process is called longitudinal rolling if the forming rolls are rotating in the opposite directions and flow of work material is along the length of the jaw and perpendicular to the central line of the rolls. By this process, we can produce products like bars of different cross sections, steel for constructional work. Flat products like plates and sheets of various thickness can also be produced by this process. Another version or type of rolling process is transverse rolling. Let us have a look at a transverse cold rolling machine. In this process, the forming rolls are rotating in the same direction and the flow of material is either radial or the flow of material is along the axis of the jaw, which is also parallel to the axis of the forming rolls.